Welcome to our review of PVA relationships. In a time history of motion analysis, we find that position, velocity, and acceleration have predictable relationships. And we call these relationships the PVA relationships. P being for position, V for velocity, and then A for acceleration. So we're going to be going into an overview of the terms that we use based on calculus, and we're going to be fleshing these out into illustrations of the graphs where we can see that the position or displacement graphs, velocity, and acceleration graphs can be interconnected.
Okay, so in a time history analysis, position, velocity, and acceleration have a relationship. And so, horizontal and vertical displacement can be measured by P final minus P initial, which is the position. So here we have point A and point B, and to find the distance between the two, we'll find the change in x first. It's the P final, which is the x coordinate 4 minus A's coordinate of 1, and that gives you 3. And then the change in y will give you 7 minus 2, which is 5. So translating that to a function of time, you have position versus time, which is velocity. And so you can plug in those values, which for x we have 3 and y we have 5. So in other terms, you could say 3 meters in 5 seconds, adding some value to that, or 0.6 meters per second. And so translating that information to the slope, you have the horizontal position over, or the change in horizontal position over the change in time. And so a steep slope, either positive or negative, will indicate that the position is changing rapidly, and a zero slope will say that there's no change in position.
So in a graph of a time relationship, we have a tangent line that intersects the time curve at one point, and in the graph, the tangent represents the instantaneous velocity or displacement. And then we also have the secant line, which on the contrary represents the average value in a graph, in a time history graph. So here is the definition of a few calculus terms that pertain to the position, velocity, acceleration relationships. Here we have the inflection point, which is the position of a function where the slope changes. Here we have the concave up inflection point, where the slope is turning from a positive toward zero. And then as it goes down, we have the concave down inflection point, where the zero slope becomes negative as the function slopes down. And you can also see this represented by these dots to kind of indicate the general region of the inflection point. Another important set of terms is the minimum and maximum. These are also called the extrema of a graph. We could talk about the overall minimum or maximum of the entire graph. So here, the maximum points of the graph would be here and here. And this is the point where the slope is zero, but the curve is coming to a maximum point. And the minima of the graph are going to be, there's only going to be one in this graph, and it's going to be right here. The slope is zero, but it's coming down from a negative slope. So the maximum coming up from a positive slope to zero, and the minimum coming down from a negative slope to a zero point. You can also talk about the local minima or maxima. So if we were talking about a specific region, so if I was talking about just this circle on the left-hand side, it would be the local extrema would just be the maximum here, and if it was going towards this way, it would be this minimum here. But then this would be all we're talking about on the left-hand side. And then what I mentioned before, the zero point, could be defined as a minima or maxima because that's where the curve comes to a zero slope. So it's not going up, it's not going down, it's just come to a stop essentially. So So concerning the terms that we just defined, we have a certain interrelationship between them. The inflection point of a time history graph is what leads to the local minimum or maximum in the next derivative. And then in the position or displacement graph, the point in the velocity curve will have a local min or max, as we just explained. And the local min or max will then lead to a zero in the next derivative, because we were just talking about how the min or the max can be defined as the zero point in the graph. So that's why we're saying that the min or the max will lead to the zero in the next derivative.
Okay, so as an example of the point of position referring to the next derivative of velocity, you can see that where the slope is positive, you have an increasing velocity, and where it's negative, you have a decreasing velocity over time. And at these points, either at the max or the minimum of the graph, like Emily was saying, you have a zero slope. And then, so using the inflection point as a derivative of the velocity, you can see that at that inflection point, you have a maximum, and then at this inflection point, you have a minimum.
Building on what Matt said, we could introduce acceleration also. So starting off with just the position graph, we have our local minima, or minima, and our local maxima. Those will be zeros on the next derivative, which is velocity. So here we have them lined up, our zero points. And then we could take it a step further and look at the local maxima and minima for velocity. And those again will become, will be zero for acceleration, the next derivative. And when we look at the slope, here it's increasing, so we have positive values for the next derivative. Then here it's decreasing, so we have negative values for the next derivative. And we can see that between velocity and acceleration too. So here we have a positive slope and positive values, and then a negative slope and negative values for that segment. So notice that the maximum for position will be a zero on the velocity graph. Same goes for the minimum. That will be a zero for the velocity graph, and the other maximum for the position will be another zero on the velocity graph. Matt defined velocity as meters per second, and acceleration is meters per second squared, or velocity over time.
So here we have an example of knee flexion, extension, and flexion. So here you could see the position of the knee in radians is moving into flexion, or moving from flexion into extension, back into flexion. And I have these lines that mark the inflection points on the graph. So here's the inflection point to the maximum of the position graph, and here's the inflection point to the minimum. And at those points, you can see for the velocity in radians per second, you have a maximum value at that same point, and then a minimum value at this inflection minimum point. And then for acceleration at those points, you'll see there's zero acceleration there and zero acceleration there. And so that also works in the reverse. So if you had a zero acceleration, you could see a maximum point or a minimum point at your velocity.
Here's another example of an object going through a projectile force. And the important thing to note here is that it's under the force of gravity. So start off, say you're throwing a ball. It's going to start at some position. At the start, it's going to arc, and then it's going to come down again. When you see the max here, as we said before, we know that will be a zero on the y-axis for the next derivative, which will be velocity. And then we know this slope is increasing, so we have positive values. This slope is decreasing, so we have negative values for velocity. And then when we look at acceleration, well, the object will be in a constant state of acceleration because gravity is a linear force. And so that will always be negative 9.8 meters per second.